Welcome to Connection with Brian and Nicole Wright.
Welcome to Connection with Brian and Nicole. We just are so glad you got to join us on another episode. And we want you to also welcome Dr. Richard and Rhonda Moore with us again.
And good to be back.
We're going to have a great episode. So if you have never joined us before, you can go to connectionshow.org. You can watch past episodes or listen to them. You can send us a prayer request. You can ask us a question, comments. Just let us know where you're watching or listening from too, and make sure you go there. We want to hear from you. And we just welcome you guys. It has been a pleasure. We've been enjoying just having these episodes with you, and
yeah,
so
it's been
excited.
It's been a joy and an honor to be here with
Amen.
You.
Yep. Amen. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. God is so good, isn't he?
He is so good.
Amen.
His presence is wonderful.
Yes.
Nothing like his presence.
Amen.
Oh, taste and see.
Yes.
That the Lord is good.
Amen.
The Lord, that means the Lord wants us to taste of him, don't it?
Yes, that's right.
He wants us to experience him.
Experience. Yeah, 1 John chapter 1, it talks about that. Because you've been talking a lot. There's an episode, there's a series that I did a couple of years ago. We talked about it called Reset, and you know, a lot of what we've talked about, it has to do with intimacy with Christ and getting to know him, going back to your first love. And one of those scriptures in 1 John talks about these. We're going to tell you about the things that we have experienced, and we tell you so that you can experience them as well. God wants us to experience him. So, amen.
Oh, yeah. We should not be void of experiences.
Yes, amen.
We should, and unfortunately today, we have a generation that knows little or nothing about the presence of God.
Yes,
I mean, they can tell you a lot about hype, they can tell you a lot about entertainment, but when it comes to his presence, not many people can tell you what his presence is.
Yes,
because they've never experienced it.
We tapped into something that last program about. You know, I'm reminded of a scripture, the willing and obedient shall eat the good of the land. And it's better to be willing, obedience better than sacrifice.
Yes.
And so there's always a price that has to be paid.
Yeah.
And Jesus was the ultimate price that he paid for all of us. And so we're talking about revival. We're talking about the fire of God. And so there's always a price. Somebody has to pay a price. And so as we traveled the country, we were paying a price, you know, dead to self and living out of our car, basically, and just going wherever the Spirit of the Lord said to go, if we had money or if we didn't have money. And so just walking and moving by faith. So there's just something about obedience, you know. And so I kind of think that obedience helps you get into hungering because you're obedient. You were sharing earlier about how the Lord was leading you. And had you not been obedient to go through that door to where, you know, a lot of people are wanting to hear from the Lord. They're wanting for him to speak to them to do something. But they need to go back to where he last spoke to them and do what he asked them
to
do. So there's just something about being obedient, having ears to hear what the Spirit of God's saying at that moment. Because a lot of times we miss God because we are not willing and we're not obedient in that moment. And it's right there, you know, because he's leading our steps and ordering us. So it's like God's the God of the suddenlies. And so that's what we see in our services, the suddenlies of God. And suddenly, like a mighty rushing wind, it sat upon each of them. Yeah. And so Richard was sharing his experience. And I think we got to the point of, where did we get? We got to Daytona.
We got past Daytona. We got to, after the Lord said, I'll pass the test.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it was the very next meeting that my whole life changed.
Where was that at?
That was up in Apollo, Pennsylvania. That was where I had just had an encounter with the Lord. And which all came about, you know, people think that, you know, here's something that it's so important for people to understand. God doesn't just pick and choose. God doesn't pick and choose, I'm going to do this for, you know, this for him and this for him, and I'm going to leave him out and I'm going to do this for her. That's not how God operates. God's a God of faith.
Yeah.
And there's things that God looks for. That God looks for faith. Remember when how many times did Jesus say to the woman with the issue of blood, came up and touched his garment, thy faith has made thee whole. What did he say to blind Bartimaeus? Because of your faith. So God looks for faith.
Yeah.
Without faith, it's impossible to please him. But he also looks at hunger.
Yeah.
Because he says to seek me. He says, come after me. He says, I'll reward you if you diligently seek me. And so some things happen in people's lives because they come after God. Mm-hmm. And there's some things that God wants to do, but he can't do mm-hmm. because people won't come after him. And God is a jealous God. God wants to be sought after.
Yeah.
And, you know, I find that also the Christian, especially ministers, they get more caught up in what they can do for God when they should be caught up in knowing him.
Yeah.
Because God's more interested in us having a relationship with him more than he is
yeah.
the things we can do for him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, because that's what really Christianity is, it's a relationship.
Yeah.
It's, I mean, that's why Jesus came, to restore a relationship to where God can come again and just through the cool of the day come and fellowship yes. with us and talk yeah. to us to where we're not a stranger to him.
Yeah.
And so many people are strangers to the Lord, and that's not even what Christianity is. Christianity is about having a relationship with God. It's about intimately knowing him. The Bible says, they that know their God will be strong and do exploits. So that's I mean, look, those who, when individuals become Muslims, they don't enter into a relationship with the God who they think they're serving. Only right. Christianity. The moment you make Jesus the Lord of your life, you now enter into a relationship with a God.
Right.
You can come boldly anytime you choose to the throne of God. And God wants us to come after him. That's why prayer is so important. That's why we should constantly be talking to the Lord on a regular basis, constantly speaking to him. And it's amazing what will open up.
Yeah.
You know, like the quote I read last week of concerning when A.W. Pink talked about the treasures that are in the Word of God that are yeah. only going to be available to the mm-hmm. diligent seeker. But it's the same with us. The moment we begin to seek God, we begin to activate Jeremiah 29,
yeah.
13. Because yeah. he said, if you come to me, you'll seek me. And there's so much that's available, but there's so much that's not being released. There's so much that God's not doing and showing because people aren't coming after him.
Right.
God wants us to come after him. I remember.
And when they do, he responds.
He always responds, yes. 100%. You know, earlier before we were talking about, you know, Smith Wigglesworth. Mm-hmm. And I'm very good friends with Frank Summerall.
Right.
And which was Lester Summerall's oldest son.
Right.
So I've talked to him a lot about, especially some of the things his dad experienced, because he traveled with Howard Carter, who was used right. mightily in the gifts of the Spirit. And you know, he spent months with Wigglesworth. And, you know, Lester Summerall Smith Wigglesworth invited Lester Summerall to come and hang out with him. Mm-hmm. And I remember the story when Lester first came. He came and knocked on Wigglesworth's door and had a newspaper under his arm.
Yeah.
And, you know, Wigglesworth's like, what is that yeah. under your arm? He looked at his umbrella and said, throw it out. He hollered at him. I don't allow lies in my house. And he sat down and had him sit in a chair across from him. And his form of fellowship was he read his Bible out loud for an hour, and then he prayed in tongues for an hour.
Yeah.
And he said, thanks for coming and fellowshipping with me. Come back again. Mm-hmm. And throughout, but he would keep coming for months. And he'd come every day almost for months. Mm-hmm. And he said, I never ate a cold meal. I ate a hot meal. It was served hot. But we'd sit at the table, and his prayer was he'd open the book of Ephesians and read the whole book of Ephesians. Yeah. I mean, but this was the type of man. But yet, you're getting a little bit of glimpse into why he yeah. had incredible miracles.
Right.
Nothing just happens.
Yes.
And I said all that to say this, is that when the war hit, all the Americans had to come back to America. And Lester Summerall went to Wigglesworth's house and said, look, they're making me go home. And then he prayed for him. And he said, you know, I see a coming revival. You're going to be a part of it. And he said that Wigglesworth said that, now, Lord, let the same spirit that's upon me come to this yeah. young man. Mm-hmm. And he said he walked out the house, opened the gate, shut the gate behind him, turned, and as he's walking down the sidewalk, all of a sudden he said, like something from heaven hit him. And he like jumped. Mm-hmm. And he said, I knew immediately what it was. He said, mm-hmm. I knew immediately that the very thing that was on Wigglesworth was imparted into me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the thing that's so sad about it is, what the great thing about it is that happened because Lester Summerall was hungry.
Yeah.
But the sad part of the story is Wigglesworth would invite all the Bible school students, and he would invite seminary students to come and hang out with him. And none of them took him up on that. And just think what some of these other future pastors could have had. He said, not one time in 3 months that I was there did I ever have, did Wigglesworth ever have a visitor.
Mm.
But think what was available. So much was available. But yeah. What was the very thing that kept, and it's the very thing today, that keeps Christians from experiencing God?
Yeah.
They're satisfied.
Yeah.
Because when you're satisfied, you say, I don't want anymore.
Right.
You push it away.
Right.
And when you're satisfied, you really cease to exist because you get cut off.
Yeah.
Because God comes to hungry people. And you know what? Here's the fact. God would jump over 1,000 satisfied people just to get to one person that's hungry for him.
Yes.
And hunger's an action. And that's really what happened with us. And when the Lord touched me, and as a result of that, of being hungry, my whole life changed. And now we've done over 7,000 revivals since 1990. You know, we've sent around the world 64 times, 44 nations of the world.
Yeah.
And almost every state in America. And not because of anything, but I was hungry for God, and the Lord touched me. And now the same fire that fell on me in January of 1990 is the same fire that falls today, still to this day. But that's really the mark of Christianity. Because Jesus was told, John said, when Jesus comes, he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire.
Yeah.
And then you see the fulfillment of it in Acts chapter 2.
Yeah.
When the 120 were gathered together on that day, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, filled the whole house.
Yeah.
And guess what happened? The fire of God came and set upon them. Yeah. We should be, as Christians, we should be marked by the fire of God.
Yeah.
And here's another concept that we have to get away from. The fire of God is not something that should be manifested in the four walls of the church.
Right.
The fire of God is in the move of God, and the signs and wonders are to be taken outside of the four walls of the church.
Right.
You know, in Mark chapter 16, Jesus said, go into all the world. You know, that's not a suggestion.
That's right.
It's a commandment. But yet he didn't send us empty.
Right.
That's why the fire of God is so important, so that we don't go forth empty.
Yeah.
You know, a long time ago, the Lord, in one of our meetings, the Lord began to speak to me because we're teaching on the anointing. And he said, because first off, we are the body of Christ. The way Jesus acted and the way things Jesus did on the earth is how we're to act and what we're to be doing, because we are his body. We're the body of Christ. But Jesus, understand, Jesus did what he did because he was anointed by the Holy Ghost. And yet he said in John chapter 14, Jesus said, that which I have done, you're going to do.
Yeah.
Well, listen, if we're going to do what Jesus did, we have to have what Jesus had.
Yeah.
If we're going to do what Jesus did, we have to be full of what Jesus was full of.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to be full of what he was full of. Hungry.
And the Lord provided for it in John, right following that in John 17, he says, you know, he says, I'm not just praying for these that are here. I'm praying for all of those that will believe on me through their word. And then he says, and I send them, talking about everyone who will ever believe, as you sent me into the world, I send them.
Yeah.
And in other words, the way that he was sent, we have the ability to draw on that same anointing, that same power to be sent just like Jesus was sent. And when we recognize that and realize that, we start looking at things different. We start operating in this world totally different. And that is not for fivefold ministry only. That's right. For believers, right. If they'll just pick it up. And so,
I like a quote that Andrew Murray, he quoted. He said, there's two types of Christians, the soul winner and the backslider. And you know, when you really think about
it. That cuts to the chase.
It really gets right down to really what Christianity is. And, you know, not everybody, and those of you watching, not everybody is called to be in a fivefold ministry.
Right.
You know, in your church, not everybody's called to be in the fivefold ministry, but everybody is called to tell people about Jesus.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's
like that.
Yeah. And listen, we have a guy, and here's the thing, that getting people saved is actually the easiest thing you ever do. Getting people saved is so easy. It is the easiest thing to do. And I laugh when people say, oh, you don't, I've heard Christians and I've heard the ministers, evangelists say, oh, you don't want to go to that area. You know, they used to say, you don't want to go to New England. Oh, it's a preacher's graveyard. I'm like, seriously?
Yeah.
I mean, some of our greatest revivals have been up in New England. I mean,
right.
I find it's like the Lord said to me. He said, you know what the Lord said? Because I'm talking, I said, Lord, that's such a silly statement. The Lord said, it's only hard for those who don't have anything from me. Mm-hmm. But when you have something from heaven, when you've had an encounter with God,
yeah,
because you quoted it a few weeks ago, John in Jeremiah 29, mm-hmm. 13, seek me and you'll find me and search for me with all your heart. But the very next verse, you quoted it, I will be found
by you.
By you.
Yeah.
That means wherever you go, God will be found there.
Yeah.
I remember, and we have story after story after story after story after story. I mean, I cannot tell you the times I've gone to rent a car. And as I'm standing in line, all of a sudden the power of God hits the lady behind the counter.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, it just happened not long ago.
Yeah.
I mean, I go to rent a car and I'm sitting here standing in line, and she's helping another guy. And when he walks away, I step up to the counter, and all of a sudden the power of God hits this lady. And she starts laughing uncontrollably. And then she's trying to apologize because she don't know what she's laughing about. And I start having fun with it.
Yeah.
What's happening? Oh, I don't know. I'm sorry. And she's laughing. I said, no, it's fine. She laughed so hard that the lady, her boss actually, was behind in another room, opened the door, come out and said, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And she said, I was fine till he stood here and just laughing uncontrollably.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it was so crazy. But I thought it was so enjoyable because I watched it get off on her boss.
That's awesome.
She started laughing, and then she ran.
Yeah.
And so, but the point is this, you become a carrier
of
the things of God, and wherever you go, God is found there. So that day when I was at the Avis rental car, God was found there.
Yeah.
We're carriers of the glory of God. But you have to come to that place. You got to empty yourself, as my wife talked about the last session. You got to empty yourself. And you know what? He has to come to the place in our life to where he is first.
Yeah.
There's absolutely nothing before him. He has to be first.
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember years ago, the Lord said to me, he said, when you come to the place to where everything means nothing to you, then you're ready for everything.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
So he has to be first. And then when he's first, guess what you do? You come after him.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's easy. People say, well, I'm not hungry. Well, then get hungry. It's easy.
Yeah.
It really is to get hungry.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you might not be hungry for food, but yet you can go eat a sandwich even when you're not hungry. I mean, it's the same way with when it comes to things of God. Now, you can get hungry.
Yeah.
But it's amazing what opens up spiritually. It's amazing what opens up when we begin to get hungry and begin to cry out to him.
I think when I've lacked hunger before and then recognized it and got to the place where I recognize it, you know, the Lord would almost always say, go crack the Bible open and start reading, or go get on your knees, start praying, or turn on some worship music, praise music, start praising and worshiping. In other words, and I think it's Proverbs 16:3, I believe, that says, commit your works to the Lord that your thoughts might be established. It's amazing how when we just do what we know is right to do, regardless of how we feel, that all of a sudden the Lord meets us at that place. And that's goes back to the willing and obedient as well, which we were just talking about willing and obedient in church, and Brother Hagin's story about that, where he was needing to eat the good of the land.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said, the Lord said, your word says that if you get willing and obedient, I will eat the good of the land. He said, and the Lord said, you don't qualify.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and he said, I wasn't eating
yes.
the good of the land. My family's not eating the good of the land.
No,
when
the
he
said,
you didn't qualify.
Yeah.
And so we think that we qualify for all the blessings in the Lord. But, you know, the Bible, there's
but
always
you gotta make it, the Lord said to him, you don't qualify. He said, you're willing, but he said, you're obedient, but you're not willing.
But you're not willing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yes.
He said, I got willing real quick.
Okay, yeah. But to get back to qualifying, you know, there's always the blessing, but then there's a condition.
Yeah.
So when you meet the condition, you get the blessing. And so, obviously, he wasn't in meeting the condition of God's word. And so, sometimes we get out from underneath that, and we think that everything's coming in line with the word, but you might be missing something.
That's right.
And so you need to go back to the word, see what the word says, check up on yourself, what you're saying, what's coming out of your mouth, what you're believing, and what you're trusting in Him for. So,
you know, the thing is that if God wants us, if we're willing and obedient, and we'll eat the good of the land, if God wants us to eat the good of the land, then He also wants us to wear the good of the land.
Yeah. Yes.
Then it means He also wants us to drive the good of the land and live in the good of the land.
Yeah. Yeah. He delights in the prosperity of us. Yeah. There was basically one of the things I was going to talk about here was in 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 10. Under the righteousness of Christ, we have taken on His righteousness. And in righteousness, we've been afforded all things. He basically said, all things are mine. But just because we've been afforded all things doesn't mean that we walk in all things. And one of the things that I thought was very important, in other words, just because we have it available doesn't mean that we have the fruit of it in our lives. 2 Corinthians 9:10 says at the end of that verse that, and it's talking about seed time and harvest, but it talks about an increase, the harvest of your righteousness. So we can increase what righteousness has afforded us. Or the other side of that is we can decrease in it. But we have the ability, based off of what we qualify for, what we do in willingness and obedience, to raise that level or not raise that level, you know. And I had, you know, there's the verse, there's a lot of people, I think that a lot of people are so taught in their religion that this is hard for them to get, but it's just scripture. Mm-hmm. There's a thing saying that goes around right now, and it's kind of one of my pet peeves, is it says Jesus never promised it would be easy, you know. And I'm thinking, he said my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I was like, He did promise. Yeah. But there's a difference between how you handle what comes against you. For example, in the boat with the storm, His disciples had it hard because their focus was not on the Father. Jesus' focus was on the Father. He was in the same situation.
Yeah.
Now, onlookers would say that's a hard situation, but Jesus didn't have it hard. He had it easy.
Right.
And He said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. And I think that's a really good indicator of where we're walking at. In other words, so if our life is not feeling easy and light, that's an indicator that we got some kind of yoke that we've put on that's not His.
Yeah. Well, the Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it says the opposite of that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Persecution, yes. But see, even in persecution, I can be easy in persecution because my eyes are set on Him.
And you're difference. In His presence.
Yes.
Yeah. You can be going through hell, but yet His peace is upon you.
Yes.
Which makes it easy.
Like Stephen, even while he was being stoned, here he is, he's looking up, he's praising God, you know, and that's
And the Bible says he saw that he was in the glory.
Yes.
He didn't feel nothing.
No, I don't believe so either. No. I've always said that.
Yeah. It's,
and that's, there's other indicators of that all throughout the Word. Where,
well, I remember when Rodney, you know, his precious daughter, Kelly, died when she's 18, cystic fibrosis, and he said, which also the statistics say, I forget the number, it's very high, that couples who lose a child, the statistic for divorce is so high. Mm. And he's like, my wife and I, Donna, and I didn't even consider that. It wasn't even in our thoughts.
Yeah.
He said, because what happened, I mean, in my mind, there can be nothing worse than holding your daughter in your arms as she takes out her last breath.
Mm. Right.
And yet he said that when that happened, a supernatural peace.
Yes.
Just came upon him and Adonica.
Yeah.
And so that was a hard thing they're going through, but yet it was easy.
Yes. Yeah.
Because you're now in Him.
Yes.
You're in His presence. He is your rock. He's your salvation. He is our salvation.
Right. Yeah.
He's our source of everything. He's our strength.
Yes.
That's right.
And that's why we got to live this life out through Him.
Yes. Yeah.
And is it hard? Yes, it is, but yet,
yes,
you're in His presence, which makes it not hard.
Yes,
exactly. The peace of God.
That's right.
Yeah.
And see, somebody who sees that and understands that and knows how to take what grace really is and use it as empowerment in that moment, they're able to be in the storm and bring a peace to the storm instead of the storm bringing them into a storm.
Exactly.
You know?
That's right.
And that's
exactly.
A, That's a great, great thing. And that's where we eat the good of the land, you know, is when we get into that place where we see the goodness of God, where we know Him, where we have that intimacy with Him, and all of a sudden we're walking in that place. And the things of the world, they don't affect you as much like they used to, you know. Right. And the flesh and its ties and its bondages, they become less and less.
Well, look at Paul. Look at all what Paul went through.
Yes.
Shipwrecked and stoned and beaten, but yet...
Yes.
Did it look like he had a hard life? Sure, it was probably in the natural, but yet...
Yes.
He also understood his presence. Yes. My grace is sufficient for you.
Yes, yes.
You know, the Lord said to him. So, you know, I remember hearing and this seems how the Holy Ghost is leading this. I remember years ago... If you've never read the book, Fox's Book of Martyrs, it's phenomenal because that's really our heritage.
Yeah.
And I remember in it, because you look at every all 12 of the disciples were martyred.
Right.
Well, obviously Judas, you know, committed suicide, but all the others, the 11, were martyred. So, but I was reading a story years ago. I never forgot it. And it was during back in the days where they, you know, like 1200s or some 1500s, maybe they burning Christians to the stake.
Yeah.
And there was this elderly Christian and this young Christian who were both going to be burned to the stake. And the young Christian it was like having one of those moments. He's freaking out, didn't know how am I going to handle this? And because there was a candle burning, they was both in the dungeon. There was a candle burning. He takes his finger and sticks it in the candle. And he pulled his hand back. He said, I couldn't even handle my finger on the flame. How am I going to handle my body in flames? And the old man said, His grace is sufficient.
Yeah.
His grace is sufficient. And he said, I'll go first. And so the young man said, while you're in the fire, if God's enough for you in the fire, for me, hold up a finger. And he said, I'll hold up a finger. And I'll prove to you that God's enough. The same presence that showed up with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego as they were thrown into the furnace. It's the same presence that will be with you.
Yes.
And to make a long, long story short, run out of time here. Sorry. They put him, burned him to the stake. And so the young man's watching him, and he's trying to, and the flames are engulfing him, and he's trying to look and see if he can see the man hanging with a finger. And finally, there was a break in the flame, and the old man standing there with two fingers up.
Yeah.
Signified to the young Christian who's going to be, you know, burn the stake next. God's not just enough.
He's more than enough. Yeah, more amen. Enough. He sure is.
He's more than enough.
Yeah. Amen. You want to wrap us up?
I'm trying not to cry.
God's good.
Is so good.
Yeah.
You know, and out of all of these, the thing that I hope you're getting the most is, until God is your only hope, you'll never be satisfied.
Yeah.
You know, you can run, you can look in every corner of the world, you can have all the fine, expensive things, but until God is your only hope, you will never be satisfied.
Yeah.
So just call out to God now, Lord, you are our satisfaction. Lord, we come to you with all that we have or all that we lack. We come to you, Lord, and say, Father, take my life, make it yours, Lord. We invite you into our lives. We give our lives to you, Lord. We thank you for your son dying on the cross for us, Lord. We thank you for all the blessings that he died for us to have. That we receive him now as our Savior and the fullness of that salvation in our lives. And we thank you, Lord, for the life that we have in you. And I just encourage you, seek him.
Yes.
Open up the word. Turn on the praise music. Cry out to him and ask him to make himself real to you. He will.
He will.
Yes. He will make himself real to you in a way that you have never known. He is a good father, and he's looking to bless you.
Amen.
Thanks
Amen.
For joining us. Join us again next week. Join us on connectionshow.org. What you got?
Next week, let's go over the fire. Yeah. What happened? Have a good one.
Thank you for joining Brian and Nicole for this week's broadcast. Connection is all about connecting you more intimately with Jesus, where you can find true joy and really live. Contact us or watch more shows online at connectionshow.org. We love you. Have a great week.